All right, so y'all go ahead and do the factoring and the math knowledge question for today. Pause the video, and then once everyone is finished, you can unpause the video and I'll go over the correct answers. So for the factoring, you should have x plus 7 times x minus 2. For the math knowledge question, they tell us that the radius of the circles are 10. And then we want to find the value of x. So this length here would be 20. And so we can use the cosine of angle x, which is adjacent over hypotenuse, which is 1 over 2. And then we can do cosine inverse of 1 half to find x. And if you plug that into your calculator, you'll get 60 degrees. This is basically just a 1 square root of 3 and 2, or 10 square roots of 3 and 20 for your side lengths. It's a base of a 30, 60, 90 triangle. So some of y'all may have recognized that. Or you can just use your cosine to find the value of your angle. So we're looking at lesson 5 today, exponents and radicals, complex numbers, areas of similar geometric figures, and then diagonals of rectangular solids. So the first three should mostly be review. The last one is going to be new, but the other one should be review from either geometry or algebra 2. So hopefully you'll understand and remember some rules about exponents and radicals, complex numbers. For the areas of similar geometric figures, hopefully you'll kind of remember that as we go over it from geometry. And then the diagonals of rectangular solids, that's the new thing. We haven't ever talked about that. So y'all need to make sure to pay attention for those. So we're going to review here. When you have the same base and you're multiplying, your exponents get added together. So it's going to become x to the n plus m. When you are doing x to the n to the m, you have a power raised to a power. These exponents get multiplied together. So you have x to the n times m. And then when you're dividing, you subtract your exponents. So you're going to have x to the n minus m. So hopefully you've dealt with those before. You kind of remember them. Whenever you're going into from a radical into an exponent, there's an understood one here on the square root. There's an understood 2, and so you're going to write it as 1 over 2. So the square root of x is the same thing as x to the 1 half. For the cube root of x squared, if you wrote it as an exponent, it would be x to the 2 over 3. So the only time that they really want you to ever write fractions with a slash instead of doing like we just did, I wrote 2/3 instead of writing 2 over 3, is when it's in the exponent. So if you had me before, you may have seen me mark that out and say, write it like this, or I've told you to write it like this. But when you put them in the exponents, that's really the only time that it's acceptable to write it with a slash instead of a horizontal bar. So just so you know why that's the case. I think it's mainly to make sure that it fits in the numerator, I mean in the exponent, to write it with the slash so you have a little bit more room for your numbers. So we want to simplify this. So the first thing that you're going to do is to put each piece pulled out of a radical. So the first one would be x to the 3 over 2. And then the next one would be y to the 1 over 2. And then the next one would be x to the 1/4. And then y to the 3 over 4. And so that's getting them out of radical form. And then after that, we're multiplying so we can add our exponents. So if you add 3 halves and 1/4, you can make a common denominator of a 4. So instead of it being 3 over 2, it would be 6 over 4 plus 1 over 4, which would give you x to the 7 over 4. And then for the y's, we would have 2 over 4 plus 3 over 4, which would be 5 over 4. So that would be your answer for that one. Okay. Okay, so looking at this next example, it's a little bit different. We've got a power raised to a power here that we first need to take care of. So we have a, instead of x over 2, I'm going to write it as 1 half x. That's the same thing as x over 2. I think that'll help with making it a little bit easier in just a minute. And then we're going to have y to the 2 times 1 half is 1, and then 1 half times x. Now to move these two to the numerator, we have to subtract them. So that means we're going to change the sign of them. So it's going to become negative 3x and then y to the positive 2x. From there, we can combine by adding. So we have this a term and this a term. So it's going to be a to the 1 half minus 3. You can write 3 as 6 over 2. And so 1 minus 6 would be negative 5 halves x. And then for your y, we have a 1. And then we have a negative 1 half plus 2. So 2 minus 1 half is 3 halves. So 1 plus 3 halves over, and then an x. You could, instead of writing 1 plus 3 over 2x, you could make it 2 plus 3x over 2 if you wanted to, because 1 is the same thing as 2 over 2, and then we have 3x over 2. So you could do either one of these. I don't care which one you do. But that would be your answer. Okay? So we're going to look at another one. It's not simplified because we have negative exponents with a plus sign. And so we're going to have to take care of this. And we can't just do the reciprocal. That's not how it works. You actually have to go through a little bit more work than that. So the first thing you're going to do is to take the reciprocal of each term individually. So that would be 1 over x squared plus 1 over y squared all over 1 over xy. So you can't just take this and flip all of it because there's this plus sign. If you had this, then you could make it go x over x squared y squared. You could flip if that was a negative. You could flip this whole thing, but since there's a plus sign here, you can't. You have to flip individually. So then we're going to make one term in our denominator. So we have 1 over xy. We've got one term. And then in our numerator, we have two terms that we have to turn into one. So the denominator of it would be x squared times y squared. And then this would get multiplied by y squared. And then this one would get multiplied by x squared. And then from there, let me come over here so I have some room. You're going to multiply the numerator by the reciprocal of the denominator. So x, y over 1. Because instead of dividing, you can multiply by the reciprocal. And then from here, one of the x's will cancel. And one of the y's will cancel. And so that'll leave you with y squared plus x squared over xy. And so that would be your answer. Let's look at another one. We did these in Algebra 2, so hopefully you kind of have a vague memory of doing these. I'm going to go over them just in case some of y'all have forgotten. We have a radical that has a fraction inside of it, and so the first thing you want to do is to make it so that you have 3 square root of 3 over the square root of 2. Instead of the square root of 3 over 2, the square root of 3 over the square root of 2. And then minus 4 square root of 2 over square root of 3. And then plus 2. And then we want to try and factor the 24. And so 24 factors as 3 and 8, and then 2 and 4, and 2 and 2. So we have 3 2s and a 3. From there, we are going to multiply this first term by the square root of 2 over the square root of 2, because that's what's in the denominator. We can't have a radical in our denominator. And then here, we're going to multiply by the square root of 3 over the square root of 3. And so that'll give us 3 square roots of 6 over 2 minus 4 square roots of 6 over 3. And then on this last term, if we have a pair of any number, we can pull them out. So a pair of 2's comes out, and so we have 2 times 2, which is going to be 4, and then we have square root of 6 left in our radical. From there, we want to make a common denominator. So the denominator would be a 6, because that's what 2 times 3 multiplies to give you. And then 3 times 3 is 9, square root of 6. The radical doesn't change. And then 2 times 4 is 8, square root of 6. And then 6 times 4 is 24, square root of 6. And then you can combine your like terms. So 9 minus 1, 9 minus 8 is 1, plus 24 is 25. Square root of 6 over 6. So that would be your answer there. Okay, so we're going to look at this one now. We want to distribute. So if we distribute, we'll have the square root of 2 times 1, which is the square root of 2, and then we'll have the square root of 2 times the square root of x, so minus the square root of 2x. Since they're both the square roots, we can put them both together under one radical. You don't have to, but you can. I'd rather do this than having to write the square root 2 square root x, but that's just a personal thing. And then we have plus the square root of x, and then we have minus the square root of x times the square root of x is just x. And then if you look, we don't have any like terms, so this is as far as you can simplify it. Okay, so now we're going to look at complex numbers. You should know that the square root of negative 1 is I. And that I squared is equal to negative 1. That all should be reviewed. Standard form for your complex numbers is A plus BI. So you would write 2 plus 3i, or negative 3 minus 4i, or whatever. The I part always goes at the end. Okay, so let's look at an example. We want to simplify these. If you remember doing these from Algebra 2, you're probably not going to have to show all of the steps that I'm going to go through, and that's fine. You don't need to, but I'm going to go back over them just in case you can't remember how to do these. So the first thing that I would do is to break everything into I squareds and I's. So I cubed is I squared times I. I to the fifth is I squared, and I. 2, 4, and then 5. Then we have minus 3I, and then plus 2I squared. And then all of your I squareds are going to become a negative 1. So that's going to be negative 1. That's going to be a negative 1 and a negative 1. Okay? So that's what you would do next. From there, you're just going to simplify each term. So we have minus 3i plus 2i minus 3i and minus 2. So if you combine, we only have one part that doesn't have an i, so we have negative 2, and then negative 3 plus 2 minus 3 is negative 4i. And so that would be your answer. Okay, now we're going to look at another one. This one has them all in radicals instead of i's. They'll start to mix them up. It doesn't really matter. You have to simplify them. So the first thing to do is try and get rid of the radicals if you can. So we can't simplify the square root of 3, but we can take out the negative and make it an I. And then the square root of 4 is a 2. And so I'm going to put the 2 out front. For the next one, we have 3 Again, we have square root of 2 with an I, and then the square root of 9 is 3i. Because the negative pulls out to make that I, and the square root of 9 is 3. For this next one, we would have the square root of 16i because of the negative, and the square root of 16 is 4, so we have 4i and then plus 4. So the real part that we have right now is the 4, but if you look here at this term, I times I becomes an I squared, which we know that I squared is a negative 1. So we really have negative, and then 3 times 3 is 9 squared root of 2. So that's what that whole term becomes. Not just one I, it's I squared because there's an I times an I. Then we have plus 4i plus 4. So the real part that we have is 4 minus 2 squared root of 2, and then plus 2 squared root of 3 plus 4i. And the way that the book writes it is a plus bi. So this is your answer. And you want to get in the habit of putting the parentheses around your a if you have more than one term, and then factoring out the I if you have more than one term for your imaginary parts. So that's how that one would work. Okay, so now we're going to look at the areas for geometric figures whenever they're similar. It tells us the scale factor between two rectangles is 4. What is the ratio of the areas? So hopefully you remember for any figures that are similar, if your scale factor is something, the ratio of the perimeters is that same scale factor. The ratio of the areas is squared, and the ratio of the volumes is cubed. So if they tell us the scale factor is 4, the ratio of the areas is going to be 16 to 1. Because 4 to 1, 4 squared is 16, and 1 squared is 1. Okay? So that would be the ratio of the areas. Looking at another one, this one requires a little bit more work. It tells us the radius of one is r, and the radius of the other is 3r over 5. And we want to know the ratio of the areas of the first circle to the second. So the first circle is r, and the second circle is 3r over 5. So this is the scale factor. And we want to simplify this before we square it. So this would be r times 5 over 3r, because you can multiply by the reciprocal, which would just be 5 over 3. And so then your ratio of your area is going to be your scale factor squared. So 5 squared is 25, and 3 squared is 9. So 25 to 9, or you could write 25 over 9. Either one would be fine. Okay, so now we're going to look at the new part, the diagonals of rectangle solids. So this is going to require a little bit of thinking, I would say outside the box, but we're inside of a box really. But you do have to think about it a little bit carefully. You're taking one diagonal, one vertex here, and then making the diagonal over to here. That's the length that we're looking for. Okay? So to do that, we're going to start down here. With this right triangle. And we're going to find the length of our hypotenuse. So if we do that, x squared plus y squared would equal the hypotenuse squared. And so the hypotenuse would be the square root of x squared plus y squared. Okay? So that'd be using the bottom of the rectangular base. And then if I use that hypotenuse that I just found, and this side length, and then the diagonal that I'm looking for, that makes another right triangle. And they tell us that z is the height, so that means that this side is the height. And so now we're looking for the diagonal. So h is the square root of x squared plus y squared. So h squared plus z squared equals the diagonal squared. Well, this over here, the square root of this squared is just x squared plus y squared, and then plus z squared equals your diagonal squared. And so you can take the square root of both sides. So your diagonal is equal to the square root of x squared plus y squared plus z squared. So that would be the length of your diagonal. Okay? One thing I want to point out before I go over this any further. Let's see. We know that 3 squared plus 4 squared equals 5 squared. That's a Pythagorean triple. And if I take the square root, some of y'all may be tempted to say the square root of 3 squared is 3, and the square root of 4 squared is 4. So that equals 7. But we know that 3 squared plus 4 squared, the square root of that is 5. And so if you have a sum under your radical, you can't just get rid of the radical. That doesn't work. Okay? So this would not be x plus y plus z. That's not how that simplifies. All right, so does anyone notice a pattern? I'm going to erase all of this stuff over here. Anyone notice a pattern in relation to what they gave us on this figure and our answer? Y'all can pause the video if y'all want to think about it a little bit longer. The pattern is that you take your length, your width, and your height, and you do x squared plus y squared plus z squared, add those together, and take the square root of it. Okay, so that's how you can actually do these without working them out completely. You can just go straight to the end. So let's look at this next example. Okay, so we want to find the length of the diagonal AC. And it wants us to do a two-step development and not to use a formula that we just went over in the last example. So we can make sure that our work follows and check our answer using that formula that I just showed you a minute ago. But the first thing that we're going to do is to draw a right triangle here. And then we know that this side length over here is 3 because this one's 3. So if we find the hypotenuse, it's going to be 2 squared plus 3 squared, and then you're going to take the square root of that. So your hypotenuse is going to be the square root of 4 plus 9, which is 13. From there, we can make another right triangle, which will use this length AB, the hypotenuse that we just found, and then the length from A to C. And so there is a right angle here. So the hypotenuse that we just found is one of our legs now. So square root of 13 squared. The height of this is m, so plus m squared. And then that length equals the diagonal squared that we're looking for. So the square root of 13 squared is 13 plus m squared equals d squared. And then if you take the square root of both sides, the diagonal is going to equal the square root of 13 plus m squared. So that would be your diagonal length. Now, if we use the formula that I just told you about, you would just take your length squared plus your width squared plus your height squared. And if you simplify that, that gives you 4 plus 9 plus m squared, which 4 plus 9 equals 13 plus m squared. So it gives you the same thing. So on your homework and on your test, I don't really care if you do either the development or you just use the formula. Whatever you prefer is fine with me. That's up to you. But that's how you can work through these. So hopefully that helps you a little bit with lesson 5. Your homework, you do get to omit number 24, 25, and 26, and that's because those are ones that would have been done with lesson 4, and we got to skip lesson 4 because that was a geometry concept, and we did constructions in geometry. So we are not doing them in pre-cal this year. So you have 27 problems instead of 30 to work through tonight.